Welcome! I'm so glad that you tuned in. My name is Allison Schmid, and I'm the pastor here at Lansing United Methodist Church in Lansing, New York. Today is Easter Sunday, the day we remember and celebrate Jesus' resurrection from the dead and God's gift of eternal life and eternal love. I'd love to know who's watching and where you're watching from. If you're able to leave that on Facebook Live, it will let others know that you're here too and help build our sense of being together in spite of social distancing. There are notes or a program order of service on our website, lansingunited.org, and also on our Facebook page. There are words to the hymns, and this week we will also have words to the hymns on the screen. And I want to thank you to all of the folks who've helped make this happen, to those assisting with worship today here in the sanctuary, Bob Keefe, Bob and Elena Fortes, Marsha Lynch, and joining us remotely, Mike Ziegler, Teresa Eggleston, former pastor Bill Gottschalk Fielding and Leopold the Camel, and Sharon Powell and Diane and Glenn Withiam, and hundreds of United Methodists from all around the world. So let's get started. I invite you to light a candle if you have one at home and join me in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, help us to be present in worship this day, even as you are already present. Amen. The traditional Easter greeting is Christ is risen, and the response is Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia, alleluia. Let's try that. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Amen. Will you pray with me again? Holy God, we thank you this Easter morning for your presence here with us. We thank you that you have called us your beloved children and blessed us that we might bless all the families of the earth. You have led us through many wilderness journeys, and in Christ, you have promised to remain with us until the end of time. This Easter is different for many of us. Due to the coronavirus pandemic, we're staying home, avoiding public places, and washing our hands over and over and over again. Our rituals of gathering with friends and family to enjoy holiday worship or a special holiday meal have been interrupted, as have our expectations around work and school and even grocery shopping. The cares of this moment have dulled our memory to your work in our past, and the constant bombardment of coronavirus news has distracted us from the peace you offer. We need the renewing of our spirits. We long for the reassurance of your love that is stronger than death. O God, O love that will not let us go, break through the barriers of our isolation and the layers of insulation that surround us. Open our hearts and by your grace assure us that we are not separated or even socially distanced from your presence. As people who yearn for resurrection, in this moment of silent prayer, we confess the things that separate us from you, including our fears and doubts, and the ways we have broken your heart by what we have said and done, and by what we have left unsaid or undone. Hear our silent prayers, O Lord. Brothers and sisters, hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. This proves God's love for us. In the name of the risen Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen. Our first hymn is one that is sung by Christians around the world. And literally, I invite you to sing it with hundreds of Christians from Africa, Eastern Europe, the Philippines, and the United States. They've joined together virtually to sing a hymn written by Methodism's founder, John Wesley, in 1739. Christ the Lord is risen today. You may even see some familiar faces as people of all ages, some in their pajamas and some in their Easter best, have joined together. As you are able, please join them in singing, Christ the Lord is risen today.
Acts chapter 10, verses 34 through 43. Peter said, I really am learning that God doesn't show partiality to one group of people over another. Rather, in every nation, whoever worships him and does what is right is acceptable to him. This is the message of peace he sent to the Israelites by proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. You know what happened throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached. You know about Jesus of Nazareth, who got anointed with the Holy Spirit and endowed with power. Jesus traveled around doing good and healing everyone oppressed by the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did from Judea and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him up on the third day and allowed him to be seen, not by everyone, but by us. We are witnesses who God chose beforehand, who ate and drank with him after God raised him from the dead. He commanded us to preach and to testify that he is the one who God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, and everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness for sins through his name.
Good morning, friends from Lansing. My name is Bill Gottschalk-Fielding, and a few years ago, I was privileged to be pastor of the Lansing United Methodist Church, and folks called me Pastor Bill, and when I did children's time, I had my friend Leopold here. You want to say hello, Leopold?
Hello, everybody in Lansing. Good to be with you today.
And we just wanted to join you for a few moments and just say Happy Easter. So, Happy Easter. Leopold, why don't you say Happy Easter?
I don't think I can.
Why not?
I'm not feeling very happy today.
But it's Easter, Leopold. Why wouldn't you feel happy?
Well, I don't know, but happy is not what I'm feeling. I'm feeling other things today.
Well, what are you feeling?
Well, I'm feeling kind of sad today. I'm sad because I can't be in Lansing in person. I can't be with my friends. This whole COVID thing is making me sad.
Oh, well, I understand.
I'm also feeling angry. I'm angry that I can't be with my friends and I can't do Easter egg hunts and I ran out of gummy bears and I can't get them and I'm just angry.
Oh, okay, well.
And, well, most of all, I'm kind of scared. Well, all this talk about, you know, disease and people getting sick, and it's just really hard for me to be happy, even at Easter.
Wow. Well, you know, I can understand all that. I think you're not alone. I think many of the people who are watching us today, even on Easter, are feeling sad and angry and even afraid. But if that's how we felt or how we're feeling, we're not unlike the people that were at the first Easter. Do you remember who was at the first Easter? Oh, yeah, there was a Mary and another Mary and a Peter and a John.
Yeah.
And each of them on that first Easter felt sad because their friend Jesus had died. They were very sad. They felt angry because it wasn't fair that he had been killed. He was a good man. And they felt afraid because they had seen some terrible things and they thought that all their dreams were over. But then, do you remember what they found when Mary went to the grave that first Easter?
Yeah, she found that the stone had been rolled away.
And when she looked into the tomb, it was empty.
And then later on, she met Jesus.
That's right. And she and Peter and John experienced a wonderful thing, didn't they?
Yeah. Jesus had come back
and they didn't feel sad anymore.
No.
And angry.
No.
And afraid.
No, they didn't.
They felt great joy because Jesus was with them. And he still is.
Oh.
So that's why I can feel happy even now?
Even now.
Oh, that's great.
Well, in that case, I can say Happy Easter.
Yep, Happy Easter.
And I can also say, you take good care of yourselves there in Lansing. You social distance. It's kind of hard when you're a puppet to social distance, because, you know, you have to be kind of close. And did you wash your hands? Yes, I washed my hands. I did. Because, you know, you're real close if you didn't. Did you sing happy birthday to me when you washed your hands? I don't remember. Well, you could do that. That'd be a good thing. Anyway, happy Easter, friends. Have a wonderful day. Happy Easter. You have a wonderful, wonderful Easter, because Jesus is risen.
I'd like to introduce to you my friend Teresa Eggleston. She's a ministry associate at Kasawasco Camp and Retreat Center. She's also a biblical storyteller. And on the shores of Lake Owasco at sunrise, she's going to tell us the story of the first Easter morning.
Mary stood weeping outside of the tomb, in which she knelt down to look inside. She saw two men dressed in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been, one at the head and one at the foot. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" And Mary told them, "They have taken my Lord away, and I don't know where they have laid him." Now when she said this, she turned and she saw Jesus. but she didn't know that it was him. And he said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" And supposing him to be the gardener, she said, "They have taken my Lord and my teacher away. Please, sir, if you have moved him, just tell me where he is and I can attend to him." Jesus said, "Mary." She looked up, said, "Rabboni, my teacher." Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go and tell my disciples that I'm ascending to my God and to your God, to my Father and to your Father." So Mary went, and she ran and told the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." Oh, and she shared all of the things that he said to her. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Teresa, for bringing that scripture from the Lakeside Chapel at Kasawasco. Would you all pray with me? Holy God, you prompted Mary Magdalene and Jesus' first disciples to proclaim and believe the good news of Jesus' resurrection. "I have seen the Lord." Grant that as we consider their witness, the convincing power of your Holy Spirit will confirm our faith that Jesus is the Christ, and that through this faith we may receive new life in his name. And now, dear God, either through me or in spite of me, speak the word that your people listening today need to hear. Amen. I am so grateful for Teresa's interpretation of Mary Magdalene's tearful discovery of the empty tomb, and also for Leopold the Camel's admission that it can be difficult to say Happy Easter sometimes. As I look out on this empty sanctuary, I can relate to Mary's despair at the emptiness of a tomb. This Holy Week has been different than ever before. On Wednesday at a Passover Seder, celebrating the deliverance of the Israelites from slavery in Egypt, we asked, "Why is this night different from all other nights?" And of course, part of the difference was that it was on Zoom, which is a very odd way to share a meal, for me at least. I'm getting used to it, however. The meal ends with, "Next year in Jerusalem, next year in peace." And those on the Zoom call added, "Next year in person." Our Good Friday service, also held over Zoom, was very poignant. The music had a very different tone than when it's played here in the sanctuary on the organ. There were 15 candles extinguished one by one, and a sense of sort of being together and sort of being very apart. And for me, the most moving portion of the service was everyone leaving in silence at the end, when we proclaim that Christ has died and all the candles are extinguished and we're sitting in darkness. Good Friday always reminds me of that feeling in the pit of my stomach that I feel at funerals. It's a combination of the grief of loss, the anger that death has to happen, and the anxiety about how families will cope, what will come next, how we'll go on. It's always hard for me to know when the right time is to leave a graveside service. It's hard to leave people alone in their grief. At the same time, I can understand how the disciples might have felt. I want badly to leave the graveside, to run far away from that ache inside. And yet, even when we run away, the emptiness follows us. I think part of what I love about Good Friday is that the pain is incredibly real. It's incredibly human. And it's followed by Easter Sunday. Speaking to the disciples of Jesus this morning, those of you who have tuned in while huddled behind closed doors at your own houses because of the threat of infection by coronavirus, is an interesting parallel to Mary Magdalene's message to Jesus' first disciples who were still in hiding, fearing that the religious authorities who killed Jesus might seek out Jesus' disciples next. I want to share with you a little bit more of the scripture that Teresa shared with us. This is the portion just before what she presented. This is John chapter 20, beginning at verse 1. Early in the morning, on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb. She saw that the stone had been rolled away from the tomb. She ran to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord from the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." Peter and the other disciple left to go to the tomb. They were running together, but the other disciple ran more quickly than Peter and was the first to arrive at the tomb. Bending down to take a look, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he didn't go in. Following him, Simon Peter entered the tomb and saw the linen cloths lying there. He also saw the face cloth that had been on Jesus' head. It wasn't with the other cloths, but was folded up in its own place. Then the other disciple, the one who arrived at the tomb first, also went inside, and he saw and believed. They didn't yet understand the scripture that Jesus must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to the place where they were staying. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The scene that I just read was the one that happened first. Mary arrived early at the tomb, and she discovered that it was open and that Jesus' body was gone. And so she ran to get help. She ran to the other disciples, to Simon Peter, and to the one whom Jesus loved, whom we assume is John, the writer of the Gospel of John. He just refers to himself as Jesus' beloved disciple throughout the gospel. And she told Simon Peter and the beloved disciple that Jesus' body was missing. And in response, Simon Peter and John raced to the tomb. John is careful to tell us at least three times that he got there first, before Simon Peter. Before he can even tell us that the tomb was empty. Before he can even tell us that the grave cloths were folded up and put away, the beloved disciple has to be sure that we know that he is the beloved disciple and that he is the faster runner, between him and Simon Peter. Reading this week, I thought, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Jesus came into a world full of humanness, that very human self-centeredness from which we need salvation. By emphasizing that the beloved disciple was the one who got there first, John almost forgets to tell us, or at least delays the point of telling us, that Jesus is risen. In fact, Jesus and Simon Peter, when they saw and believed, I don't think they believed that Jesus was risen. That was just to get them to the point of believing Mary Magdalene, that the body was indeed no longer in the tomb. At that point, instead of helping or problem solving, they ran back to wherever it was they had been hiding. And Mary was left with her tears to go into the tomb to meet the angels that were there, one at the head and one at the foot, who said, "Woman, why are you crying?" It was Mary who was there crying, who turned around and, without the help that she had asked for, asked, "Where have you laid him? Just show me, and I will take him. I will give him what he needs. I will tend to his body." She'd already asked for help, and they were no help at all. I don't know how she intended to bring the body back from wherever it had been taken, but she just needed to know, "Where is my Lord?" Her grief filled her, and one she assumed to be the gardener said, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you seek?" Mary repeated her need, and Jesus answered her by calling her name, "Mary." You know, the scripture tells us that we will know the shepherd's voice just as sheep know the shepherd's voice. Mary recognized in that moment that it was not the gardener to whom she was speaking, but it was the Lord, her teacher, her friend, her Jesus. She responds, "Rabboni." And in that moment, the new creation happens. In a garden like the first, but in a garden where sin is forgiven, in a garden where new life is found, in a garden where the one who knows our names calls us to be the people that we have been created to be. In the midst of all the political haranguing about this coronavirus pandemic lately, we, like the writer of the Gospel of John, need to get beyond who did or didn't do what and how fast in the past. We need to focus on what it is that Jesus calls us to do now, who it is that Jesus calls us to be now, to care for one another in the midst of this global pandemic. Yes, it's hard for us. We have to stay home, and we have to wear these masks, and we have to wash our hands and not do things or do them in different ways than what we're accustomed to. This surge of infections is going to be even more difficult across developing countries, where they have far, far fewer doctors and nurses and ventilators and masks, and live in much tighter conditions, in much less sanitary conditions. The point for us as Christ followers is, as it was for the man born blind, not to figure out who sinned that made this happen, or who was the slowest in getting to the grave, or who let this virus become a pandemic. But the question to us is, how can the God who is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love be glorified in the midst of this situation? That bragging of the beloved disciple recounting his story of the first Easter morning, when he ran faster than Simon Peter and arrived at the tomb first, reminds me that Jesus' resurrection story is a very human story. Just as at Christmas, we remember that Jesus is fully human, born to a poor, not yet married, Near Eastern family who has traveled far from home and probably never imagined that the birth of their firstborn would be in a stable and that his first cradle would be an animal's feeding trough. At Easter, we recognize that Jesus is fully human. He suffers and dies as a fully human being. And he is resurrected for us, also fully human beings, showing that the power of God's transforming love is stronger even than the powers that keep us separated from one another. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead is stronger than the winner of any disciples' competition to be faster than one another, or to be the disciple who sits at Jesus' right hand, or to be Jesus' most beloved disciple. The Easter reading that Mike Ziegler shared for us from the book of Acts is the speech that the apostle Peter gives when he finally begins to understand that truly God shows no partiality, but in all places accepts those who honor him. Easter assures us that the power that raised Christ from the dead is stronger than any government, even governments who prefer to kill innocent people than forfeit their wealth or power, whether it's the Pharaoh in Egypt or King Herod or any of the things that governments do today to hurt people, or even the things like gang violence in South Africa. That same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the power holding together a gangland truce in the townships around Cape Town, where on coronavirus lockdown, members of rival gangs are helping to distribute emergency food packages in the midst of the lockdown, instead of killing one another in lethal turf wars. They are helping one another to live. That same power that raised Christ from the dead is the same power that God offers to you and to me to take away all our sin, to remove all that is past, all that we are willing to let go of, that separates us from becoming the people that God is calling us to be, giving us the power to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever form we see them, giving us the power to build and enter into the kingdom that Jesus taught, where the hungry are fed, the sick are healed, and the poor have good news preached to them. With all the trappings of Easter morning missing this year, or at least some of them, I hope that we are able to more clearly see God's love poured out for you and for me and for all people, offering us forgiveness, inviting us to continue to journey into new life, new hope, new commitment to creating the beloved community that Jesus began here on earth. May it be so among us. Amen. Each week as we gather together, we have an opportunity to envision that beloved community and to be a part of it. Part of the way that we do that is by holding one another in prayer. And I would invite you now to enter any prayer concerns that you have, either in an email to me at pastor@lansingunited.org or to office@lansingunited.org. The difference is the ones that you email to office will become public and will be part of the emailed out prayer concerns during the week. The ones you email to me will just go on my personal prayer list. And if you'd like, you can also share prayer concerns on Facebook Live. Or you could pick up the phone and call a friend and share this time of prayer. I want to share some of the concerns that have come in this week. So I'll offer some moments of silence for you to pray, to share those concerns, and then I'll raise some of the concerns that have been raised this week. And then we'll join together in our Lord's Prayer. Let us continue in an attitude of prayer. We pray for those who are working in healthcare and other essential businesses. Lord, protect them, keep them safe, and may they feel our strength and our thanks that they are doing for us what we cannot do for ourselves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for Matt Elliott and family, Crystal and Adlin and Asher, who lost their home in a fire on Monday morning. We pray for family members and friends who are on the front lines, for Sarah, for Sadie, for Hallie, for Eli. We pray for Drew and Michelle and Aubrey and Emma, all of whom have a virus. We don't think it's COVID-19, but we pray for their comfort and healing and rest. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for those who are currently hospitalized, and for those who've recently come home from the hospital, for Mary, for Jan, and for Jim, and for Loretta. We pray for Dorothy, for Donald, and for Zeal. We pray for Karen, Matt, Stephanie, Melissa, Monica, Aaron, and Laura. We pray for those who are grieving, especially the family and friends of Gerd Asen and of Marianne Rudy, and of Roger Hurt. We pray for all those who grieve, especially in this time when it is hard to gather together and we have to grieve from a distance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for those who are celebrating birthdays, for Lorraine and for Max. And we pray for those who are expecting new life, who are even now looking forward to births in the future. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those places in the world, places like Cape Town, South Africa, places like the jungle here in Ithaca, places where we're seeing glimpses of the beloved community, places where God's love is breaking through. May our homes and our lives be those places as well. We pray together with the prayer Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We don't have any offering plates to pass this morning. Usually I would pass a plate from hand to hand to hand, and when coronavirus is over, perhaps we'll have to come up with a new way to collect offerings. Our time of offering is not only a time of asking for financial gifts to support the work of the church. It is also a time of dedicating ourselves to Christ's work through the church and in the world. It is a time of responding to God's call, a time of saying yes to having heard God call our name and invite us to believe and to follow. What would you give for an empty tomb? What would you give for a risen Savior? What would you give for a restored community? What would you give for a gospel message that endures? We gave nothing. It was given to us by grace, without price. And in return, we are invited to dedicate ourselves to the building of Christ's reign on earth, offering our whole selves to God's work in the world. And so we ask, bless these offerings, O God, and those who give them, that through them, your work might be accomplished in this world, that this place might be the place where your kingdom come and your will is done, here on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Will you join me in singing our doxology?
Thank you.
This Easter celebration has been different for me than any previous Easter celebration. Perhaps it's been different for you as well. We have a new hymn to sing, as if we didn't have enough things that weren't familiar. It has a very familiar tune, The Church's One Foundation, and the words are by Carol Winfrey Gillette. This Easter celebration. The words will appear on your screen. Thank you for worshiping with us today. And thank you to all who made this possible. Thank you to everyone who sent in Easter photos and to those who are helping out with sound and music and Elena who helped with our bulletin cover for this morning. There is an invitation to a virtual coffee hour, which will be on Zoom at our church phone number from 10:30 or so until about noon, so feel free to stop by. You have to bring your own coffee, but a virtual coffee hour from 10:30 to noon on Zoom. And it is a tradition at Lansing United Methodist Church for all to join in the Hallelujah Chorus at the end of Easter services. And so we have found a number of different Hallelujah Chorus options that you can go to join in singing. And those are going to appear on your screen as links, and they're also posted on Facebook. So we invite you to have a good sing-along. Go ahead and turn the volume up and sing Hallelujah. And I invite you to receive this Easter blessing. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. May you see the face of the risen Christ in everyone you meet. And may everyone you meet see the face of the risen Christ in you. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia. Amen.